Lay here from Leah4sci.com with video 2 of the nucleophile and base analysis for substitution and elimination reactions. Catch part 1 along with the entire substitution elimination series at Leah4sci.com/substitution-elimination. In part 1 of this video, we discussed how to differentiate between strong bases and nucleophiles versus weak bases or nucleophiles by looking at charge. The next thing you want to look at is the attacking atom. What if you have two atoms that both have the same charge? You have to look at which one is more reactive when holding that charge. There are over 100 elements on the periodic table, but I highly recommend memorizing the placement of the following 10 atoms. Knowing where these atoms occur on the table helps you remember the following two trends. Electronegativity goes up and towards the right, and size goes down and towards the left. If we take a look at atoms on the same period, for example, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and fluorine, giving each of them a negative charge does not make them equally reactive. Since fluorine is the most electronegative, it will be happiest with that charge and therefore least likely to attack. However, carbon, on the opposite extreme, is the least electronegative, will be the least happy with this negative charge, and therefore even more likely to attack. And since the trend for electronegativity is carbon less than nitrogen, less than oxygen, less than fluorine, a negative carbon will be the strongest base or nucleophile when compared to a nitrogen, which is stronger than oxygen, which is stronger than fluorine. However, as you go down the periodic table, the atoms start to get larger and their electronegativity decreases. So not only do you have a less electronegative atom, but because it's bigger, it has the ability to distribute its size, making that negativity less effective. And so the trend for strength decreases as you go down the periodic table. Since fluorine has the most concentrated charge, it's going to be the most reactive, followed by chlorine, followed by bromine, and followed by iodine, given, of course, a negative charge on each of these atoms. There are exceptions to every rule, and this occurs in polar protic solvents, which we'll talk about in the next video. In part 1 of this video, I mentioned that some bases are terrible nucleophiles and some nucleophiles are very weak bases. So let's start with the bases that make terrible nucleophiles, and these are typically referred to as the triple B or big bulky base. The most common example that you're going to see is tert-butyl oxide or tert-butoxide. This molecule has an O negative, making it very strong and very reactive. The O negative is bound to a carbon, which is bound to three other carbons, making the entire molecule very, very bulky. In chemical terms, this is referred to as steric hindrance, which tells you that the molecule gets in its own way. Have you ever tried to walk through a narrow door carrying a really big umbrella? You as a person can get through the door, but because you're carrying a very large umbrella, it actually gets in your way and prevents you from getting through. Same thing happens with a big bulky base. The oxygen is strong and negative and wants to attack, but because the rest of the molecule is so big, it tends to get in its own way. Now think back to substitution and elimination reactions. In a substitution reaction, the nucleophile attacks the molecule and remains attached to that molecule after kicking out the leaving group. Whereas in an elimination reaction, the base simply grabs a hydrogen, which collapses a bond and kicks out the leaving group. If a big bulky base tries to act as a nucleophile, it actually gets in its own way and prevents itself from attacking a molecule as a nucleophile. So instead, it has to resort to sneaking up on a side hydrogen of the molecule and pulling off that hydrogen, which causes the elimination reaction. So anytime you see a big bulky base like tert-butoxide, the first thing that should come to mind is an E2 reaction. We said that a molecule with a negative charge will be strong and reactive, but there are some cases where you have a very strong acid that gives you a very weak conjugate base. For example, whenever you have an acid made of HX,
where X can be any halogen,
it will break up and give you H+ and X-. These atoms have negative charges, but they're very, very weak bases and therefore will not participate in elimination reactions. When you recognize a negative atom or molecule to be a very weak base, it can still act as a nucleophile, but will not act as a base. Instead of memorizing all of these, try to understand what happens and why so that you can apply it to many different molecules. Let's take a look at iodide or I-. I- is a very large atom with a distributed negative charge. So even though there is a net charge of -1, if you look at any part of the molecule individually, it will have a fraction of that charge.
However, if you bring this large molecule near a positive charge, the molecule, or in this case the atom, will polarize, meaning there will be a slight separation of charge because all of the negativity will be attracted towards the positive charge on the carbon, leaving the other end of this molecule slightly positive. There will be enough negativity concentrating near that carbon, allowing this molecule to act as a nucleophile. In other words, if you have a molecule that is highly polarizable, it can act as a nucleophile even if it happens to be a very weak base. This is not limited to halogens. If you look down the periodic table, under oxygen you have sulfur, which is less electronegative, but something like SH-, which is a larger molecule, or even SR-, which is larger than its oxygen counterpart OH- and OR-, will be a stronger nucleophile because sulfur is larger and more polarizable. This can also occur when you have a pi system, given that the extra pi electrons are able to polarize the molecule even more, for example in CN- or N3-. Be sure to join me in the next video where I show you how to identify polar protic, polar aprotic, and nonpolar solvents, and show you how they apply to substitution and elimination reactions.
Are you struggling with organic chemistry? Are you looking for information to guide you through the course and help you succeed? If so, download my ebook, 10 Secrets to Acing Organic Chemistry, using the link below, or visit leah4sci.com/orgosecrets. That's O-R-G-O, secrets. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and even share it with a friend or two. If you have any questions regarding this video, leave a comment below or contact me through my Facebook page at facebook.com/leah4sci. There will be many related videos posted over the course of the semester, so go ahead and click the subscribe button to ensure that you don't miss out.